a plenary is the opening convocation. It's the charge. It sets the tone. It reminds me of a place where Plato, Socrates, Aristotle sat around the Parthenon, encouraging the troops to battle. It's the place where Harriet, Fred Douglas, and King inspired a generation to move beyond the mountain of despair. Our plenary today is designed to set the tone, it's to inspire us, it's to take us to the place where ideas and action become one. There's probably no better person to address the issues of the crossroad between race and health, culture and healing, violence and wholeness, than our speaker today, the Reverend Dr. Zachary Williams. His background is fitting for this occasion. He currently serves as the Associate Professor of African American Policy, History, and Studies at the University of Akron. He is currently the coordinator of the Institute of the Black World's 21st Century Consortium. He was a fellow with the Center for American Progress Institute. He's an author, a scholar, an activist. He's one who has moved beyond the area of ideas and lives in the world of action. In 2003, he co-founded the Americana Cultures and Policy Studies Institute. He's a man of the spirit, a man of faith. He currently serves as the associate minister at Olivet Institutional Baptist Church here in Cleveland, Ohio. He's a man of education, has received his PhD in American and African American policy history. Dr. Carey, his background is so eminent, I thought I would see that he was a Morehouse graduate. But he holds a BA from Clemson University. He's a family man. Surely this morning, he will inspire us to reflect upon and act upon the state of disparities, but he will move us beyond the disparities to reflect upon true emancipation, health, wholeness, and opportunity. Won't you put your hands together as you receive our speaker for today, Dr. Zachary Williams.
Invitation, and just want to simply say, I was almost a Morehouse man. I went to a Morehouse man in the room, that's not enough, but I have, my, somewhere back at home, my certificate that's signed from the 90s, I'm dating myself, of acceptance, but was unable to go for various socioeconomic reasons. But I still hold that to this day, and my sort of journey has taken me in some ways back, and actually my first job opportunity out of college that was official landed me back there. But I took the route of academia, but I was brought back again through the person of Howard Thurman, who has influenced to where I'm now. So I'm certainly grateful for that introduction. But more than that, I have to give honor and praise to God for this dynamo. This institution in and
professional skill. And if you are in my presence for 5 minutes, you are compelled and drawn like a magnet, because what moves in her is the move of God.
Amen.
And so I'm blessed to be in association and in fellowship with a visionary and a movement maker, a 21st century trailblazer, Ivanka Hall. I want to thank God for her and all of those who have worked tirelessly for this conference. And the reason why I want to say that is because it connects to how I want to intro into this, my few comments. And let me just apologize ahead of time. I don't have PowerPoint, so I know that's a first strike against me. So I'm gonna try very hard to be, good on time and to move through, meticulously so that we can get through. But I told her, all I need is a good meal. I don't need anything else.
All right.
And, you know, we live in an age where, you know, we can get into that conversation where that's a different sort of thing for a lot of folks operate in public and scholars and the like, but when you, your heart is in the movement,
yeah,
and for Black Lives That Matter,
amen,
and yes, when we say Black Lives Matter, all lives matter,
yeah,
you do it because you need to. But also, she reminds me a lot of my grandmother, who passed in January, but was in, had an indelible influence on me. And her key in life, she raised 3 children on her own by herself, with a community she pulled together that helped raise me. But she was a cook at a local school, and she always wanted to ask the question, have you eaten anything? So for me, as long as I got good food, I'm good. So when I think about her, I think about her and also how this all ties in everything else, because she was also domestic and took care of other folks' children, then after that came home and took care of her own. And this is interesting because it connects into my talk, Black Lives Matter, the State of African American Health Policy after Ferguson, Cleveland, Baltimore, and beyond, because it helps to highlight the importance of narratives and story as an important part of who we are as a people. You know, we've survived through slavery and the like because of the stories we've told. In some ways, the stories we've told with metaphors and ideas that held hidden meaning so that we could survive, thrive, and be sustained. And so those narratives are still running throughout our experience, even as we deal with the current challenges that are mounting and connect with challenges that are historic. It connects with the other narratives I want to connect with in terms of collective and personal narratives in understanding the African American healthcare experience and policy in historical perspective. And I'll try to make a sweep before I'm done. It makes me think of Toni Morrison's work, her recent book, God Bless the Child, which talks about the struggles of pain and suffering in childhood that follow a young woman all the way into her adulthood. It helps me think about Junius Wilson, the 24-year-old man in Goldsboro, North Carolina, who was institutionalized and said to be criminally insane, although he had never been diagnosed ever in his life. And he was kept there for over 70-something years and released only in the 1990s. And everyone knew the truth, but it was withheld. Right? It makes me think of Ta-Nehisi Coates and his work Between the World and Me. In the vein of James Baldwin, he talks about his struggles and frustrations with being Black in an America that doesn't seem to value Black lives. It makes me think about the story of my grandmother and others, and all the stories that you see in the documentary, and all the stories that you hold yourself. Which leads me into how these narratives connect with the research in racial health disparities. Researchers and scholars Paula T. Ross, Monica Lipson, and Arno Kamagi in August 2012 issue of the Journal of Black Studies examined the manner in which African-American patients use illness narratives as measurement mechanisms to explore the presence and prevalence of racial discrimination in healthcare and healthcare policy. Interviewing a sample of 12 African American adults in relationship to their experiences of discrimination with the healthcare system, they concluded a consensus of perceived discrimination and differential treatment. The intuitive experience of discrimination made it necessary to develop techniques to compensate for the lack of equal treatment received.
And this continues on. And their research shows us that healthcare in the areas of aggressive cardiac intervention, insufficient pain management, less therapy for colorectal cancer, less rigorous diabetes management, which my grandmother had, and many more times the number of lower extremity amputations, which she had, are given to African Americans over and above other people. Additionally, they highlighted the fact that racial and ethnic minorities in seeking treatment were more aware of physician bias. It's this sense that we have, that we're not welcomed and wanted. And lack of cultural sensitivity held less trust in the healthcare system and reported a significantly lower level of satisfaction with the healthcare they received. Ultimately, African Americans, they conclude, experienced the worst health status, suffered the worst health outcomes, and historically have been forced by social structures, legalized segregation, social exclusion, and overt discrimination to use worse health services and facilities compared to other racial and ethnic groups. I haven't gotten even into food and nutrition, and grocery stores and neighborhoods of food deserts. So when we talk about Black Lives Matter, when folks say, yeah, you need to say all lives matter, I say, no. In many ways, Black lives have been the centerpiece of American democracy from the beginning. You take out Black Americans and there is less of a democracy in our nation, because we have breathed life, even through our struggle, into the meaning, into the words of the documents of this nation. But we have to deal with the history and how we have been disproportionately disparaged from the beginning up to now. Furthermore, cities such as Cleveland, I'll skip further, and their own distinct social location as it relates to origins and evolution of socio-historical factors culminating in contemporary racial health disparities among African-American residents must be acknowledged. The age range of the study in question spanned from 21 to 61. The study featured a variety of conditions such as hypertension, schizophrenia, miscarriage, restless leg syndrome, lupus, multiple sclerosis, multiple myeloma, diabetes, and stroke. And when you go through all of these, you probably find this somewhere in our history. But I want to read a couple of the narratives before I go on and get to my 4 points that I'll talk about in terms of the objectives. The first narrative, Mr. King, a 73-year-old retired social worker in cardiac intensive unit, said, quote, one day this nurse comes in with this pill between her fingers and says, here, take this. Now, they usually have little cups like this, and they open the medicine without touching it and drop it in the cup. Now, why did this woman think that it was all right for her to walk in with a pill between her fingers and hand it to me? I don't think she was deliberately being discriminatory. He says, I think she was just racist. He's 73 years old. She felt that she didn't have to adhere to the customs and mores of healthy practices because my skin was a different color. I'm convinced of this. I don't think she would have done that if I were a white man. His position. Second point, Mr. James, a former basketball player and coach, regarding public assuming the worst of African Americans. With a white person, he says, they always think of all the other alternatives before they think of the worst. In other words, they think A to Z. With minorities, they start with Z and they work their way up to S. Which makes it unfair to a lot of us, and immediately it makes getting good medical care a problem. Next, Ms. Hall, a 29-year-old living with multiple sclerosis. The medical examiner, she didn't believe that it was anything wrong with me. I remember her because I remember when she was examining me, certain things, that intuition. She would look at me like there's nothing wrong. And everything I was telling her was a lie. I know that my medical records show everything, that I'm not lying. And then Mr. King, wife with sickle cell anemia. My wife had sickle cell anemia and she had a sickle cell event or episode. It took the healthcare delivery people over an hour to get to our home. When they finally arrived, she was dead. I was told by the locals that the treatment was the standard operating procedure for dealing with African Americans. The practice was that they did not service African Americans in need of emergency health care unless they had nothing else to do. The first priority was to make calls to white citizens. That was my introduction to how the society values Black human beings. Black lives matter. All lives matter. These are just narratives from one sort and study, and then there are, of course, others that connect to that. But what I want to talk about briefly, four things we'll try to rush through and be done. One by mirroring past and present. I hope to illustrate the manner in which racism is and should be viewed as a public health matter and a public health policy issue. Two, I want to grapple with the meaning of the long memory, long-term implications of racial disparity with respect to African-American health and healthcare in the age of President Obama. Three, demonstrate briefly how the intersection of social, political, economic, and cultural issues caused, and continue to complicate the resolution to long-standing racial health disparities among African-Americans. And four, envision and begin to chart a bold way forward. First, racism is a public health issue. Sociologists Joe Feagin and colleague Karen D. McKinney in their influential 2005 book, The Many Costs of Racism, concentrate on the experiences of middle-class African-Americans who voice an outcry on the consistent and persistent damage done to black life by institutionalized racism. The central point made in the book is offered in response to a response by a black entrepreneur to the following question. What is it like to be a black person in white America today? Her answer, one step from suicide. What I'm saying is the psychological warfare games that we have to play every day, every day. Just to survive. In my head, I'm thinking of two things. One, I'm thinking of the black vernacular. But another sense, I'm thinking of, for the hip hop generation, Talib Kweli, just to get by, you know. All right. So I don't care whether you are a domestic worker or a PhD at a university, the same rules apply. So we're talking about all across the board. Black health is being challenged. And so that's what we're dealing with today. That's what this conference is dealing with. That's why it's so important. Feagin and McKinney's study reveals middle-class black complaint regarding the blatant, covert, and subtle discrimination found in the workplace and everywhere else, and the manner in which this experience impacts all dimensions of their lives. Physical and mental health, family life, and involvement or lack of involvement in community affairs. He talks about systemic racism being at the root of it. Not just an incidental, isolated incident, but a continuous, connected set of patterns that are interconnected with other social forces that contribute to it. So this is huge, and not insignificant in the way that people try to make it out to be. Chapters 2 and 3 focus on the psychological and physical health consequences of contemporary systemic racism against black folk. Most notable is the level of anger and frustration expressed at workplace treatment, what some folk call collegiality. Collegiality means treating African Americans as the other. And if you're African American woman, that's a whole nother thing. And when you perceive it, again, this perception, the sixth sense we have, the boys talked about, it's perceived as being out of line and totally off base. And we're suggested just to laugh about it, you know, or tell a joke or something, and it'll all kind of go away. But in addition to anger, respondents shared similar symptoms and ailments of depression. Anybody ever had it? Fatigue, sleeplessness, stress, headaches, hypertension, and stomach problems. And shows emphasis on, you know, on black life, but the conclusion concentrates on the ways racism plays out in the healthcare system. Teresa Wilter, on writing behalf of the Pew Charitable Trust, penned a January 26, 2015 piece, many African Americans fall into a health coverage gap. Among the things she included, blacks are more than likely to die from cancer than any other racial ethnic group. Blacks are diagnosed with AIDS at 9 times the rate of whites and are much more likely to depend on the emergency room for their healthcare than whites. Blacks are 40% more likely to have high blood pressure and twice as likely to be diagnosed with diabetes. Black women are 40% more likely to die from breast cancer. Mortality rates among black infants is more than twice that of non-Hispanic white infants. Research demonstrates that people with insurance on average are healthier than those without, adding to the racial health gap intensified by the lack of coverage of many African Americans who remain uninsured, and the impact of the politics of Medicaid expansion is devastating on blacks who live in metropolitan areas like St. Louis. Ever heard of it? The St. Louis area of Missouri, where the state made the decision, the governor made the decision to opt out of Medicaid expansion.
Right.
Now, Now, of course, we took a different route, but it was a journey to get there.
Okay. Yeah.
And in my home state of South Carolina, I have to hang my head. The governor, all along, they were resistant to bringing down the Confederate flag and are still resistant to what they call Obamacare.
Yeah.
So the battle, you know, still continues. The nation's capital, there remains a battle being waged against unequal access experienced by low-income African-American residents of the District of Columbia. And here you have works by Georgetown law scholar Robin Whipple Diaz, who works with her colleague Cheryl Cashin, who's done work, Place Not Race and the Failures of Integration, to talk about how the public official proclamation of healthcare is a right, we really say a human right, is coupled with challenges to eliminate health disparities. It's based largely on the confluence of race and income. And among the challenges faced by then mayor was limited access confronting providers of Southeast DC residents. Now we have our equivalents in this city and their equivalents all over the country. But everywhere you look, next to a Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard, mm-hmm. in his honor, who by the way said that in 1966, healthcare should be a human right.
Yeah.
You have people who are living under the quality of healthcare. How are we honoring that legacy? I want to go forward and somebody please wave your hand in terms of time or come, you know, and let me know if I'm going too long. Despite hopeful optimism and reinvigorated leadership in DC and the DC corridor, in the form of Muriel Bowser in DC as the mayor, and Baltimore Stephanie Rawlins Blake, a good deal of urban challenges of access continue in DC and elsewhere, especially with closure or consolidation of hospitals that previously served the African American community, commingled with hyper-segregation, extreme inequality, black hyper-incarceration, public education crisis, among other interlocking issues. It's only by the grace of God, I think, that we're even alive.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Black health disparities, it's a number of forces that are connected with the school system. But we're met with school to prison discipline. You know, hyper segregation, hyper incarceration. At every point, the policy toward us is discipline and punish rather than reception, inclusion, forgiveness, and love.
All right.
All right.
So there seems to be something that's really out of step. And so if you look at what's happening in D.C., it really shows a lot of issues. Generational structural racism continues to impact African-American health, individual, and communal. History shows this trend remains unabated, morphing from one phase of American history to the next. Today's racial health disparities are indicative of the convergence of numerous historical and institutional forces that render African-American health on life support.
Amen.
A transformative African-American health policy agenda must be enacted that takes into consideration the unique history, circumstances, and condition of African-Americans in order to effectively address across the board suffering. The American Public Health Association, if you ever go to its website, whose motto is For Science, For Action, For Health, bears witness to the central fact that racism is a public health issue. Quote, the recent events in Charleston, South Carolina, Baltimore, Maryland, and Ferguson, Missouri, remind us that stigma, inequalities, and civil rights injustices remain in our society today. Unfortunately, skin color plays a large part in how people are viewed, valued, and treated. We know that racism, both intentional and unintentional, affects the health and well-being of individuals and communities and stifles the opportunity of many to contribute to the future and growth of this nation. The place where I was a fellow for a few years, the Center for American Progress, its affiliate group, Think Progress, came out with the question in an article, why racism is a public health issue, and they offered these 4 points to prove it. Then I'll move forward to the second point. One, racial discrimination puts black Americans at risk for long-term health problems. Merely fear of encounter. I didn't say the encounter. The fear, constant microaggressions, fear of encounters of regular racial discrimination puts blacks at a disadvantage health-wise, as fear triggers incessant stressors, which in turn exacerbate ill health across the board. Harvard anthropology doctoral candidate Jason Silverstein, in an Atlantic piece, How Racism is Bad for Our Bodies, concludes that racism operates within a cycle to damage health. People are at social disadvantage. People who are at social disadvantage are more likely to experience stress from racism, he says. And they are less likely to have the resources to extinguish this stress because they are at a social disadvantage. He continues, just the fear of racism alone should switch on the body's stress response systems if we think our environment contains threats. In our communities, the crime, we're always on and never off. How can we be healthy, whole, and wise fully? But it raises the question that is prevalent in the study of the impact of our discrimination on health. Let me move forward. Two, the majority of doctors harbor unconscious racial bias toward their black patients. This takes me to the long battles between the National Medical Association, you know, the black group, right, and the American Medical Association, right? Who for a long time, Medical Association barred blacks from participation and warred over policies such as Medicaid and Medicaid. And if you look at the research, there's a lot of policies that the National Medical Association put forward in order to try to advance black causes. And among those champions of the National Medical Association was cultural and physical anthropologist William Montague Cobb, who's a professor at Howard, who through the venue of medical anthropology demonstrated that if you look at the research and tailor it to specific cultural aspects of black life, you can get at the root causes of black disparities and provide adequate treatment. But research on figures like him pretty much has gone unnoticed, unrecognized, and unvalued by the larger medical establishment. And so if that research that really pertains to our condition is ignored, then what do we do? But there's also other research that talks about this case of embodied inequality, to where we walk around and wear this phenomenon that challenges us. But then there's a long memory of African-American health disparities in historical perspective. In 2011, Richard Allen Williams, founder and president of the Majority Health Institute and clinical professor of medicine from the UCLA School of Medicine, explored the historical foundations of modern healthcare disparities. In exploring the subject, he raised the following question: what is the historical background of disparities in healthcare delivery, and how did these disparities evolve? His answer to that question involves reckoning with the enslaved past and what researchers Byrd and Clayton refer to as the slave health deficit. In essence, Williams argues that slavery gave rise to a racist system of healthcare delivery. So it's institutionalized. That is still in operation in the present day. To arrive at his conclusion, Williams explored the trajectory of racism in the US healthcare industry through periods of slavery and emancipation, Reconstruction, Jim Crow, and the Civil Rights era. Furthermore, he attributes the longevity of such institutionalized racism to medical, legal, sociological, and religious participation in cultivating and undergirding such a debilitating, unequal system. And you know about the work of public health scholar Harriet Washington in Medical Apartheid, the dark history of medical experimentation on black Americans, which is as critical as Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow. So when you look at it, you got a lot of complexes that are institutionalized. Healthcare, prisons, education, media, and they're all interconnected to impact on black lives. Can we still say that black lives don't matter? But this is the mounting challenge that we face in terms of what's going on. Washington put forward the argument that incidents such as the infamous Tuskegee experiment and forced sterilization of black women and black boys, deplorable in its horrific intent and outcome, represented one episode in a continuous institutional and structural system of racism in healthcare toward black people from slavery to today. And the evidence is out there. We all need to compile it together to present it, because there are people who try to deny the validity that exists, including what was presented. It's almost as if we are clamoring for things that are undeserved, yet the facts and history bear witness and experience to the truths of what's happened. In fact, she assigns accountability to the medical establishment in particular for the mistreatment of African Americans. Even more damaging than the countless cases of unethical medical experimentation on African Americans and denial of equal treatment is the long-term impact that such mistreatment has had on contemporary generational black health and views toward the medical establishment and healthcare industry. In particular, African American suspicion grounded in experiences of abuse and unethical practices has rendered many woefully underrepresented in life-saving medical research studies. The distrust, which has roots, a lot of times keeps us from participating in health studies that could be beneficial to helping eradicate our issues. In addition to the lack of usage of research that is culturally specific and tailored to our condition. In addition to those who are in positions in the medical establishment who may or may not take into consideration all these different elements. And so how can we properly address black health disparities if we don't look at all these different things? The American Journal of Law and Medicine estimated that African Americans only represent 1% of almost 20 million Americans who sign up for biomedical research studies. But yet we're 9% in health disparities in terms of cancer. 12 or 1% in terms of the prison population, overrepresented there. What about life-saving aspects in terms of our people? Regarding the matter of the long memory of African American health, 1982 National Journal of National Medical Association study, An American Health Dilemma, History of Blacks and Health System, Bird and Clayton argued the following. The present health, black health status is a continuum. After 346 years of neglect, flawed efforts were made to admit black Americans to the mainstream health systems. Gains were significant from 1965 to 1975. However, since then, black health status has eroded. Since colonial times, the racial dilemma that affected America's liberal democratic system also distorted medical relationships and institutions. There are clear connections between campaigns to defeat bills that would improve the health of blacks. Now, are they talking about 1965 or 2015? And other disadvantaged groups and acquiescence with the present reassignment of them to the underfunded, overcrowded, inferior public health care sector. Physician leadership helped to establish the slaveocracy, they say. It was the National Medical Association. Create the racial inferiority myth and build the segregated health subsystem for blacks and the poor. Clearly, if the history-based health disparities are to be resolved, black physician leadership will be necessary. And without justice and equity in healthcare, they often say the dream of Martin Luther King Jr. Will never become a reality for African Americans. Now, talk a little bit about the National Medical Association's struggle with the American Medical Association, of which Harriet Washington contributed to that particular study. But I want to say that when considering the long memory of African American healthcare and related racial health disparities, we must address the matter of cultural trauma. Ron Ireland, in his thought-provoking book, Cultural Trauma, Slavery and the Formation of the African American Identity, advances the manner in which the disparate impact, it's a legal term in terms of the continuing impact of a precedent or a condition, of continuing systems of total oppression, we talked about it, have negatively impacted generations of black minds, bodies, and souls during the sojourn in America. In his work, Ironman explores the formation of contemporary African American identity, which dovetails with the work of social worker and social scholar Jordi Bailieri in post-traumatic slave syndrome by using the theory of cultural trauma. To do so, he concentrates on the experience of slavery, not as a matter of personal experience or as an institution per se, but as a matter of collective memory. What role does collective memory have on health in light of experience and all these other issues? You know, we talk about church, when I think about the goodness of God, when you think about the pain, the stress, and all the hell you have to go through, how does that impact, and how does the battle, how is it waged between the two? And if we did not have faith, which people say is an important part of health, where would we be as a people? I mean, you know, so his work defines the cultural trauma of collective memory as a, quote, pervasive remembrance that grounded a people's sense of self. So why did, you know, grandmothers and others have these views of distrust and suspicion? Generationally, it was passed down. Mm-hmm. You know, and it was consistent and continued. So this cultural trauma, collective memory, which people say in war zones, and those who fought in the military, not to even mention those who went to Vietnam and Korea, like some of my family who came back and were messed up, talked on the floor based on what they experienced and expected to be reintegrated into a healthy family system and lifestyle upon return. Amen. While dealing with institutionalized structures and inequality at the same time. Mm-hmm. Talk about a challenge? Mm. Wow. But we've all lived it, and many of you have survived it. But when you connect Iman's work with the work of Mary Frances Berry and John Blassingame and their work, Long Memory, The Black Experience in America, you begin to see the way in which we can understand how to get at these issues. And so we really have to think about that. Let me move forward. Let me put it this way. How does this conference on the state of African American health disparities help shape the local policy and practice agenda that could serve as a national model for how to eradicate racial health disparities in a city that privileges its healthcare industry as among the top in the country?
All right.
There is the challenge, there's the opportunity. And in 2016, the national stage will be on Cleveland. So this conference is auspicious, important, and necessary for a number of reasons in terms of agenda setting. As Makani Themba, the activist with the Praxis Project, tells us, making policy is not just something that happens at the top down, it happens from the bottom up. That's how you get the civil rights movement, that's how you get the Black Power movement, the women's movement, and every other movement in between. Because people understood democracy, took it into their own hands, and decided to engage the system to make opportunities better. For them. But for me, I also, when I was in graduate study, came to understand this other piece of policy, that there are unintended consequences to policy too. Things that you cannot measure or account for, but for which, and at which time they appear, you have to deal with. So when we talk about the exploding prison population, at the same time we're dealing with a crisis in public education, and all these other things. And so for a lot of people, when they're trying to resolve issues, they look on a single line. But you have to use, again, with the legal theorists, Kimberly Crenshaw, Derrick Bell, and others to talk about in terms of intersectionality. You have to begin to study issues in a way that is connected across lines, because they're complicated. And if you're gonna solve complicated problems, you can't have simplistic solutions to deal with complicated problems. Yeah. And if you go money after complicated problems that have been using simplistic solutions, you can always suspect a self-fulfilling prophecy. The issues would not be resolved. So the political issue is not to trivialize it or politicize it. It's to put the research and the funds and other things behind initiatives and efforts that are doing the substantial, meticulous, ongoing research that is necessary in order to help deal with these challenges. Let me move forward and get to the bold challenge. But first, let me go back just for a second. Robert Lieberman, in his book Shaping Policy, the United States Historical Perspective, uncovers one of the most serious policy matters facing the nation, that of the stubborn persistence of institutionalized racial inequality in what has been termed by political scientist Robert Smith as an imagined post-civil rights moment. Concentrating on the areas of welfare and employment, Lieberman compares the parallel histories of racial policy development and politics in the United States, Great Britain, and France to arrive at some startling conclusions. The central question of the book seeks to examine the reasons why the American nation has had such uneven success at integrating African Americans and other racialized minorities into the mainstream of full American citizenship. Furthermore, Lieberman argues for the presence of incongruency in the long trajectory of American public policy. What do I mean? He critiques the tradition of seeking to resolve racialized public policy with contemporary raceless or colorblind public policies. The rising tide lifts all boats thing. That policy for all will help deal with the peculiar, longstanding, and complex challenges of black folk. But when I've just talked about some of the things, and other speakers today will talk about more. how do you put colorblind, raceless policies as a solution to longstanding, racialized, racially created and motivated public policies and expect to resolve the issue? It's like putting a square peg in a circle hole. It's never gonna fit. But then we're still told that that's what's supposed to happen. And so what he says is Lieberman examines the historical roots of racial incorporation of these policies, and he indicates the relative success of anti-discrimination policy as a tool, noting the insufficiency of the American welfare state to adequately deal with the matter of racial inequality. And here we are today talking about racial inequality, gender inequality, still, right? As a prime contemporary example, he concentrates on the origins and resilience of affirmative action to explain his larger thesis. Further, he demonstrates how nominally perceived colorblind policies can harbor racially biased outcomes and effects. So did you hear that? Even colorblind policies have racially biased outcomes and effects. Mm-hmm. Not to mention the institutionalized nature of inequality in the system and providership. So when you add all those things together, there's a heavy, heavy challenge. But there's a way forward. In this regard, a 2008 issue, a report issued by the United Nations Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination entitled Unequal Health Outcomes in the United States showed that we must develop local, state, and federal consensus around addressing racial and ethnic disparities in healthcare treatment and focus. The U.S. ratified the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination in 1994, which dates back to the 1960s. In doing so, the officials agreed to submit regular reports to the Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. The UN group invested with the authority to monitor state compliance. The report clearly demonstrates that racial discrimination in healthcare access and treatment is a human rights violation, deserving of attention from CERD and from policymakers across the nation. The report was produced by a coalition of health policy experts and environmental justice policy experts, from academia, the grassroots, and other NGOs to advance the goal of the human right to health and a healthy environment. And then there are other things that would be put forward, but let me just kind of quickly conclude. A 2011 report issued by the United States Department of Health and Human Services Office of Minority Affairs, among them Dr. King Davis, who's a professor at UT Austin, specializing in mental health research, they offered a statement of the problem and then offered consensus statements and then a number of recommendations. Long-term disparities in access to jobs, income, justice, health, education, and behavioral health care have created an environment in which African Americans result in increased risk of trauma, disease, lower productivity and quality of life, and excessive mortality. Major barriers, they say, to accessing service for behavioral care remain. And then he goes on to provide a number of consensus statements. A long-term response to health disparities in African American communities has been the development of informal or practice-based evidence as well as the use of healers. So basically we found ways ourselves to try to invoke creative responses to things. And then he goes on to talk about other measures. Reductions in disparities are partially dependent on the quantity, quality, and skills of the health and behavioral health workforce and the type of integrated healthcare plan. And then there are others. But they offer a number of strategies as well. And in conclusion, there are scholars like Dr. Kamara Jones, who in the issues of Phylum, a journal based at Clark Atlanta University where W.B. Du Bois taught, who challenged us to move forward in confronting institutionalized racism in the health policy industry. She argued that the measurement of current conditions is insufficient as an intervention strategy. In order to effectively address generational disparities, she boldly called for research and understanding of policy mechanisms that help generate and perpetuate the health disparities in the first place. And so she lists four classes of policies that I won't get into, but which connect with a lot of these areas that I've talked about that others will talk about later today. She concluded her paper by offering an outline for an intervention model implemented at the local level as a springboard for national effort. And the first piece was naming racism by a leadership consensus. In the Black Lives Matter movement, we talk about Sandra Bland, for instance. There's a familiar hashtag, say her name. We have to acknowledge these long-standing systems of racism and inequality and discrimination in the healthcare industry by name. In education, employment, and economic segregation by name. to propose usage of community conversations as a way to understand the local location, operation, and impact of racism. And she said we must act to dismantle institutionalized racism by focusing on the structures and processes of it. Then I want to offer a few recommendations to conclude and one final point. One, we must reposition African American studies to concentrate on subjects such as historic and continuing racial health disparities, producing research, policy development, public dialogue, and civic engagement. Due to continuing racial health disparity crises in our nation, African American studies scholars, scholar activists, and community activists must be utilized as a central cultural and social capital group to develop innovative longitudinal research frameworks and initiatives. To achieve this goal, significant resources must be committed by philanthropic entities to help create policy research centers, sustain existing ones, and support collaborations for the purpose of developing coordinated projects and initiatives for the empowerment of local communities most affected by racial health disparities. Two, remember the legacy of organizations such as the Good Doctors, the Medical Health Committee for Human Rights, which is known as the Civil Rights Wing of the medical establishment, and continue to model best practices that are historically grounded and culturally rooted. Three, fund the work of social justice organizations like the NEOBHC to produce policy briefs, projects such as the Cleveland Clearinghouse on Racial Health Disparities, and continued public programming. Four, publish an annual State of Black Cleveland Health Report to document continuing challenges while projecting sustainable policy practice recommendations. Five, lobby for the creation of citizen public servant-led civil and human rights health commissions in places like the city of Cleveland to oversee sustainable eradication of racial health disparities for a significant segment of the current population. And then there may be others, which hopefully you'll add in others as well. And in conclusion, at the end of the day, after we've dealt with this enormous challenge and see all the pieces of it, we must remember the words of Sister Alicia Garza, one of the founders of the Black Lives Matter movement, who said in the familiar vernacular of our ancestors, while commenting on the Black Lives Matter convening in Cleveland that was held with over 1,500 presenters looking at all kinds of issues from health to education to residential segregation and others. She said the words that we should remember as we continue to wrestle and toil and struggle and be attentive today and love each other and care about each other. She said the words that my grandmother would have mentioned. She said the words that all of you are evidencing today by your presence. She said these words, "We gonna be all right." Generations and centuries of struggle, from sun up to sundown, never having a break, having to find innovative ways to give birth, to be healthy, to eat, to cook, developing soul food with the worst, you name it, becoming the best in areas we were locked out of, dealing with functioning in jobs while under death threats, not to mention the current president who was called a liar for the first time in history. At the State of the Union, and receive more health threats. Now I know the presidency causes stress and your head to turn white, but how much more does the stress of the presidency with you being an African American cause you to whiten or gray even more? And then there are others, but at the end of the day, through all of that, we have found ways through faith, through determination, and through diligence to continue to fight on and press, to connect head and heart, connect hope and faith and love, to press forward. And that's what we must do now in this moment, which is a momentous moment. Don't miss it. In the words of Dolores Kearns Goodwin, which he talked about Franklin Roosevelt, this is no ordinary time. Let's go back to that perceived intuition we got. Use the head and the heart, but tap into that sixth sense. And realize the moment that we're living in. And so I want to thank Sister Ivanka and the entire National Northeast Ohio Black Health Coalition, because what we are doing today is not only making history, it will change lives, change a nation in a changing nation that is changing demographically, change politics, change economy, and change anything else that needs to be changed. But the time is now. We are the people. The work is here. We are the leaders. Let's get to work.